Change from the inside out. Now, when we have baptisms, I often remind us that baptism is an outward and visible sign of God's love and God's grace. Now, that does not mean that the church and God don't care about people before baptism. Rather, it's a reminder that that visible sign of baptism reminds us of what is true. It's a reminder that God claims us as beloved and is proud of us, just as we heard in our Bible story. Now, when I prep a family for a baptism of a little one, a baby or a small child, I often will joke with the parents that after baptism, their child will be markedly different. Needless to say, it doesn't usually work out that way. When I check back in with them a couple weeks later, the child still cries, the child still wakes up in the middle of the night, all those things. Because those babies and kids that we baptize, just like each one of us, has a whole range of emotional feelings going on inside of them. And that does not magically change at baptism. So you probably remember during children's chat when we talked about that kid Riley in the movie. Now I wanted to share a clip because I'm guessing that while all of the kids had seen it, not all of us have seen this movie. So take a look at this clip introducing us to the emotions.
Just Riley and me, forever. For 33 seconds.
I'm sadness.
Oh, hello. I'm joy. So, can I just, if you could, I just want to fix that. Thanks.
And that was just the beginning. Headquarters only got more crowded from there.
Very nice. Okay, looks like you got this. Very good. Oh, that's her turn. Oh, look out!
That's fear. He's really good at keeping Riley safe.
Easy, easy, huh? I'm back! Oh, we're good. We're good. Ooh, thank you. Thank you very much.
And we're back.
Here we go. All right, open.
This looks new.
Think it's safe?
What is it? Okay, caution. There is a dangerous smell, people. Hold on, what is that?
This is disgust. She basically keeps Riley from being poisoned, physically and socially.
That is not brightly colored or shaped like a dinosaur. Hold on, guys. It's broccoli! Yeah! Well, I just saved our lives. Ooh. Yeah, you're welcome.
Riley, if you don't eat your dinner, you're not gonna get any dessert.
Wait, did he just say we couldn't have dessert?
That's anger. Cares very deeply about things being fair.
So that's how you want to play it, old man? No dessert? Oh, sure. We'll eat our dinner right after you eat this.
Right, right. Here comes an airplane.
Oh, airplane. We got an airplane, everybody.
Airplane.
And you've met Sadness. She, well, she... I'm not actually sure what she does. And I've checked, there's no place for her to go. So she's good, we're good, it's all great.
So it's not quite this simple, but this movie captures some of the complexity within which we all live. In the same way that that contemporary reading that Dina just read, there's a lot of hard things going on inside of each and every one of us all the time. We have all these emotions kind of swirling about at all times. And what the movie and Riley makes visible to us is a reminder that we need all of these emotions in order to move through change. If we try, like the movie does, if you've seen it, to experience joy all the time, nothing but joy, we will get stuck in the change process. And we will probably get stuck in life itself, because life is not all joy. We all know that, right? Now, you know as well as I do that sometimes change is forced upon us. There's a crisis, there's some sort of external something that happens, and we are forced to make some change that we had no control over. But sometimes, like baptism, change can be a self-initiated choice. Even when, or perhaps especially when, change is a choice, it's still hard. Now here we sit. It's January 29th, 29 days since that first day of the new year. How many resolutions did we make that we've forgotten about, that we're not keeping up with, that we just didn't even make because we knew we wouldn't follow through? This is not to impose guilt on us, but rather to recognize that change is hard. Change when it's forced upon us is hard. Change when we're attempting to choose it is hard. And one of those reasons it's so hard is because of all those competing emotions inside our heads and our hearts trying to keep us doing status quo. Because the joy longs to dominate for us, but sometimes we need to sit with the sadness a bit. Sometimes we need to allow anger to flow. Sometimes we need to experience a little bit of fear so that we can take that first step. Sometimes we need to let disgust settle in so we can be motivated to change. When my kids were little, one of my favorite books to read them was entitled I Am a Rainbow by Dolly Parton. And she talks about the emotional rainbow inside each of us, kind of like these guys are all different colors here. And at the end of that book, she says, "So remember, as you go from hue to hue, that each and every person has feelings too. It's not always up to you the way that you feel, but how you act is a different deal." And she finishes with, "So be a rainbow, shine from above, and filter all your glow through love." We recognize that change itself brings this wide range of emotions. And when we experience them, we are reminded that we can change. When we experience life's emotions, and we will, we are not supposed to always act out of those emotions, as we saw in the movie clip where she's throwing these big temper tantrums, because we're not two. But we are also reminded that each emotion doesn't last forever. When we're sad, we know that we're not always going to be in a sobbing puddle, right? When we're angry, we know that we're not going to be raging in anger forever. And when we're fearful, we know that we're not going to be stuck in that place of fear forever and ever. It's these very emotions, though, that motivate us to endure change. If we think about it, it's anger that motivates justice. It's fear that allows us to take a step into the unknown. It's sadness that we experience that allows us to act in charity for those around us. And it's disgust that reminds us to do something, anything. Now, with all of this, if we think back to Jesus' baptism that Dina read for us, and we remember the words that the Spirit says, "You are my child, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life." Or, as we usually hear it, "You are my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Now, it doesn't work out like the joke I make with parents baptizing their babies, but the truth remains. Something changes when we experience Jesus in baptism and other times. Something happens when we claim our identity as beloved, as the one with whom God is pleased. When I was doing Bible study with my youth in my first church, we were studying this passage, and one of the teens said, "You know, my parents, they have to love me, but they don't have to be pleased with me." So the fact that God is pleased with me, that's remarkable. Indeed, God is pleased with you. You are the pride of God's life. And it is true when we are joyful, it is true when we are sad, it is true when we are angry, it is true when we are fearful, it is true when we have disgust. And it is true that when we encounter Jesus, we are changed. From the inside out, we are changed to love our neighbor. We are changed to offer to visit the imprisoned, to offer food to the hungry, water to the thirsty. We are changed to love our enemy. We are changed to love God with all our heart, mind, and strength. So indeed, God is pleased with you. Indeed, when we experience all of these emotions, God is pleased with all of you. And God is pleased as we make those changes in our lives. All of it. God is pleased. Thanks be to God. Amen.